سلاك يا वंदेहं श्रीगुरो श्रीपदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगणरघुनाथं सजीवं साद्वतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं श्रीकृष्णचैतन्यं देवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगण ललिता श्री विशाखान्वितांश्च हे कृष्णा करुणा सिंध दीनबंध जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानु सुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये नमो महावदान्याय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदायिने कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नामिने गौरकृषे नमः पञ्चतत्त्वात्मकं कृष्णं भक्तरूपस्वरूपकं भक्तावतारं भक्ताख्यं नमामि भक्तशक्तिकम् श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासवि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे जन्माद्यस्य तोऽन्वयादितरतः चार्थे सुभिज्ञ स्वराट ब्रह्म हृदय आदि कवये मुह्यन्ति सूरयः तेजो वारि मृदाम यथा यत्र त्रिसर्वो मृषा धाम्ना स्वेन सदा निरस्तपूर्वकं सत्यं परं नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये स्वस्ति अस्तु विश्वस्य फलः प्रसीदतां ध्यायन्तु भूतानि शुभं भूयात् मनश्च भद्रं भजता ददौ शिवे ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शांति शांति शांति
रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम चैप्टर 6 चैप्टर नंबर 14 बिगिनिंग फ्रॉम वर्स नंबर 22 सो दिस इज द स्टोरी ऑफ किंग चित्रकेतु became with Vritrasura. This question was raised that how is that Vritrasura was under the influence of Rajas and Tamas could be such a great devotee. So this is a very enigmatic situation. Practically everybody thinks that to be a devotee one has to be sattvic in nature, well behaved, controlling mind, peaceful. These are the qualities which are described in Bhagavad Gita also. Krishna is describing the characteristics of a devotee. But when we see the history of Vritrasura, we don't find any such qualities except that internally he was very much devoted to Lord. So this was very intriguing, and therefore in Parikshit he raised this question that Rajastamasya Bhavasya Brahman Vritrasya Papam Narayane Bhagavati Kathimasi Dridhamati, that how is that he had such a staunch faith and fixity of the mind that even in such an unfavorable situation when his both arms were cut from the root, he was reciting such wonderful prayers. Aham hare tava pade kumbhe dasam daso bhavatasmi bhuya. I just want to be servant of your servants. So in such a situation no one thinks, you think how can I get rid of this pain and go to hospital and get some bandages. But he was not worried, he was actually telling Indra to kill him quickly. That's what he was inspiring him, because Indra was scared to attack him. So then Sukadeva Goswami started explaining that the story which I will relate to you, which I have heard from Rabbi Vyas, his own father, from Narada Rishi, and from Deval Sage. So he said that long ago there was a king by the name Chitraketu in the country of Surasena. So Chitra means wonderful, amazing. And he had many wives. Of course, here it is described as 1 crore, 100 lakhs, 10 million. So that is all, that itself is quite amazing. Somebody can have that many wives, and then all of them were barren; they could not give birth to one child. That is another amazing thing. So the idea is that sometimes our mind is also compared to a wife. We read the story of Puranjan and Puranjani. And Puranjani is described there as the mind. And in the mind we have desires. And desires are no limit. 1 million, 10 million, 100 million. They are like the wives because we follow them. Like a handbagged husband. We work for them. We try to satisfy those desires. But they don't produce anything. Nothing comes out. So you remain frustrated, because and even if your desire is satisfied, as you would say, the desire is only going to give you trouble. Because you had a son whose name was Harshadukhada, that he will give you happiness and also suffering. So that's what people get when their desire is satisfied, they feel a little happy. Then the same thing gives trouble. Because everything which gives you happiness is bound to give you trouble. That's how this world is designed by God, so that you don't become too much happy. It always remains. That's why Krishna says, Dukhalam Shashwat. So everything is temporary, therefore it's just all right. Suffering is also temporary, happiness is also temporary. And it goes into the phases. So, Chakravat Parivartan De Sukhanicha Dukhanicha. Like the chakra, it rotates. Very big. So you go up, you go down, you go up, you come down. And it goes on and on and on, non-stop. So that's what is the meaning behind it. Unless you meet a sage like Angira, who puts some sense into your head, you can become a devotee. Till the time, this chakra will go. So that is actually the meaning. So now he described how Angira appeared, Yadricha, by the grace of God or by will of the God. And he was asking him that, are you happy? Are your friends, relatives, teachers, your subjects, everybody functioning nicely? And then he also said that you don't look happy, because I can see some anxiety on your face. King was just waiting someone. When you are in trouble, you like to speak it to somebody, especially if someone is willing to hear it. That's what psychotherapists do, right?
Yes.
You think that you get paid for that.
Yes.
That's good.
And sometimes you don't. Usually you do.
So, the saying in Sanskrit that dukham nivedutva sukhamo bhavanti, that after explaining your suffering you become happy. Because mind has, this is the secret of the mind. Mind has a secret that if you speak it, then it goes out. That's why mantra is kept secret. This is the reason why mantra is kept secret. All the mantra everybody knows. Now you know about internet, all mantras are there, but these mantras have power. Because the power of mantra is only if you keep it secret. More secret than the power. So more you keep it secret, then deeper it goes. So that's why in the Vedic culture there was always this idea of secrecy. People always wonder what is so secret about it. And all the time you hear these statements, like, this is very secret, this is confidential. Now you are my friend, this confidential thing. And then you read anything, what is that? Confidential. So the idea is that these things have to be kept inside. And not that you take in Vrindanga and go on the street and give it to everybody, and it loses its value. Nobody takes it seriously, including the person who is speaking about it. He also doesn't take it seriously. Then he talks. So that's what has actually become a Vedic culture now. Bear with me, but this is a fact. This is a harsh reality. So there are certain things which are kept secret. You speak them, and they are finished. There is psychology behind it. So he is now speaking, but he wants to finish it suffering. So he speaks. Chitraketur vacha. Bhagavan kimna viditam tapo jnana samadhi yoginam dvasta papanam bhairanta sharirishu tathapi prachato bruyam brahmanatman chintitam भवतो विदुषश्चापि चोदितस्त्वदनुज्ञया लोकपालैरपि प्रार्थ्य साम्राज्यैश्वर्यसम्पदा नैनन्द्यत्य प्रजं मां चित्रकामिवापरे ततः पाहि महाभाग पूर्वैः सह गतं तमः यथा तरेव दुस्तारं प्रजया तद्विदेहिनः. सो ही इज एक्सप्रेसिंग हिज प्रॉब्लम टू द सेज इंदिरा. ही सेज, My Lord, what is not known to you? Because you are endowed with austerities, with knowledge and control of mind, samadhi. So when you control mind, then you get knowledge by that. There is something called Uttamra Pragya, described in the Yoga Sutra, and then you can know even the mind of other people. So it says, you are situated in samadhi, you are endowed with knowledge of the various sphere, and such yogis dvast papa nam bhairanta sharirishu, they can know everything what is outside and inside. So there are different ways of acquiring knowledge. One way is how the science is trying to acquire knowledge, in an empirical way. They do research, they do finding. They have discovered many things, but it is very, very limited what they know, extremely limited. Although many scientists and those who follow them, they are very proud of their knowledge. But those who are real scientists, they are not proud. They understand that their knowledge, their understanding is highly limited, because they only know 4%. What they are dealing is only with the 4% of the universe, because 96% is only dark matter and dark energy, which they know nothing about, except that it is dark. But that is the Krishna side. So 4%, we also say that there is Tripadabhuti and Ekpadabhuti. So they know nothing about Tripadabhuti. This we say 75% and 25%. We give them more chance. They themselves are saying it's 96%, which they don't know. So about that 4% also they know very little. and all the research done in that. So that is one way of knowing. Another way of knowing is going inside. So that's why it says yoginam dvast papanam bahiranta sharirishu. So that these people, they can know everything. So he says, still because you are asking, therefore I will speak. Krishna Chakrati says, sarireshu asmad videshu. People who are having body like me, means you can understand. But since you are asking, because if you don't ask, then it looks like you are very indifferent. Because if you know everything and you go to somebody's house, you don't ask anything, and that person will think that you have no interest in him. So you have to ask. There was one Ayurvedic doctor, me and Dalar, we met him long ago. So he was telling me that he had acquired some siddhi. There is one process called Swarodaya, Swaratantra. And if you practice this, you can understand the mind of other person. He said he practiced it and he got the power. He says whenever some patient will start from his house to come to him, he will already know that he is coming and what is the disease. Therefore, before he came, he will already keep the medicine ready for him. Packed. Ayurvedic, you have to make this puriya. When he came, before he said anything, he gave him medicine. He said, take this and go. So he was thinking that this is great, but the patients, they stopped coming to him. And then he was wondering why they are not coming, because I already know the disease, I give the medicine, they should come more to me. But actually the patients were dissatisfied. He said, this guy doesn't even ask us. So how does he know what we have? So they did not feel satisfied. Right? So he was telling us this. Ramakrishna Sastri, that was his name. So he said, then he stopped doing this exercise, this practice. And then he lost it. Then he started getting more questions. So now he was actually taking the pearls and talking to them and asking what is the problem. So they feel satisfied. So in the same way, although the sage Angira, he may not understand what is the problem, but still he asked that, what is bothering you? And the king also, he understands that he knows this. So therefore he is replying. It says, tathapi pruchito bruyam brahman atmani chintitam. That since you are asking, therefore I am going to explain to you what is my trouble. And trouble, of course, you know that. Bhavato vidusas chapi chodithas panutpadamya. Because you are asking me, you have told me, so I will follow the order and offer my problem. So Krishna said, Pichato Bhagavato, I am Agyakari Tirth. Said, I am obedient to you. Atmani Mansi Chintitam Chintam. So therefore I will speak about my anxiety. And by speaking, I will be relieved. And maybe some solution will come. So he says that Lokpali Rapi Pratha Samrajyeshwari Sampada, that I have Aishwarya, I have so much opulence that even the Lokpalas, the protector of the directions, they hanker for it. There are 8 directions and every direction has a protector, which is called Lokpalas. And they are very opulent. They are Lokpalas, Agni, Vayu, and they have a lot of powers, but since this king had more opulence than them. So he says, still, I am not happy. All this thing is not pleasing to me. And one may ask, why is that? So he gives an example. He says, aprajana, because I do not have any child and childless. So in India, this was the purpose of marriage. Now people have forgotten. Putrarthe kriyate bharya, putram kriyate prayojana. You marry to have a son. And the son was there so that he can give pindadan, oblation, shraddha sarana. So this was a very important principle of vanashram. This was actually one of the key principles of vanashram. It was based on that, because without marriage there is no progeny, and without any progeny there is no vanashram. But stop. Everybody takes sannyas. So that's why Brahma was always worried. The first four sons were born to him, were the Kumaras, and he told them to take care of his children. They refused. He was very angry. So this mentality is there in Indians even now. That if Indian have a son, they want him to get married. If he wants to become a sadhu, they are very upset. Western people do not know this. Those who are in media, they know this. They don't want that their son becomes sadhu and does not marry, because then they are worried how their lineage will go on. So this problem started with Brahma only. That even his sons refused to marry. So he was angry at them. And he ordered other sons, and you read Kardam. Stories. They all married for their children. To Daksha also they ordered. So this is very much in the Indian psyche, even now, although nobody much knows about Varnashrama. But this is very much there. This is one of the very big problem at present, because everybody wants a son and not a daughter, because you have a daughter, you have to get married, and you have to give a lot of dowry in marriage. It's a very expensive affair. So people are worried about that. There are many people in India, they work their whole life only to get their daughters married. But it's so expensive now. So previously it was not like that. Therefore people don't prefer daughters anymore. And this is creating a problem. That's why in India there is a law not to test the sex of the baby in the womb. Because when this technique came, then Indians were already testing. There was a baby, girl, inside, and they were about. So they have to make a law against it. So in the West, people don't make any difference between boy or girl. Same. But in India, son is always preferred, right from the very beginning. Although it is changing now. There is a lot of abhiyan. Education that we should also treat girls like boys, and people are changing. Not in the villages, still the same mentality is there. So King Chetruketu, who was ruling in this area, he also was worried about this, no son. Specifically said, no son. Because it is the son who will do pindadan. According to Varnashrama, the son has to do it and not the daughter. His daughter gets married and changes her name and gotra and everything. So the lineage changes. It has to be done by the person who is in the same gotra. So only the son can do. And this was a worry, because if you don't have a son and you die, then you go to hell. That's why son is called putra, because protects you from hell. Mahabharata, there are many stories like that. So this is something cultural. It's not so much related with bhakti. But since these stories are in the Indian setup, you have to understand the background. Otherwise one may think, why were they so much worried? These days people don't, that they get married, they don't want to have children. purpose of marriage is not children. So previously the purpose of marriage was to have a child. That was the only purpose. Otherwise, why marry? Why have the bothersome? So those who did not want to have child, they didn't want to marry. It takes a mess. So this was the only purpose of marriage. Now, this is a little strange if you talk like that. So Brahma, he was producing children even without getting married. Son. And then people were not able to do that, then they started getting married to have a son. Now things have changed. Get married, no son. And now it has to come that not even marriage. Together. Not even marriage. Because why marry? So that's why there's a big question. Many times people ask that what does Hindu religion say about same-sex marriage? Gay marriage, lesbian marriage. So people ask this question, what does Hinduism say about it? So Hinduism doesn't say anything about it. Because why you want to get married if you don't want to have a son? What is the purpose of getting gays married? You can live together. You're not going to have a putra and build a priyojana. So you have to understand the purpose, then you know the answer. So Hinduism is not against gay marriage or lesbian marriage or anything. You do what you like to do. It's not part of Hinduism. So it doesn't object to it. So the purpose of marriage is because Varnashrama Charvata Purushena Kumam Vishnu Rara Bhate Pantra. The idea is Vishnu worship, that is the purpose. So whether you marry or you don't marry, the idea is you become a devotee. And if you don't become a devotee, you can do what you like to do. You have a problem. So don't discuss this. So he says that I don't have a son, aprajam, I am aprajam. And therefore nothing is satisfying. Because when you are intent on something, when you have very intense desire, nothing else appeals to you. So this is how we have to have desire for bhakti. And when you have desire for bhakti like that, then naturally there is varagya. That's why it's said that janati asu varagya. That's why varagya comes. Because the king is having varagya just because he has a son. He does not have a son. He is very much desiring. He says nothing is... all his kingdom. If you tell him that you will give up your kingdom and then you can have a son, he will do it. Because he's not interested in it. So he gives an example. He says, Chutrita Kanam Ivapare. And then you can understand his mind. What is the situation in his mind? He said, just like a person who is hungry and thirsty. Somebody is very hungry and so you feel hungry, right? So, and you are very thirsty. Sometimes some people don't feel hungry. At least thirsty. So you are here in Vrindavan in the month of June. You feel very thirsty. You sweat a lot. It's very hot. So when you are thirsty and somebody makes you sit on a throne, says, please sit down on the phone, watch television. Or you can listen to this nice music. It doesn't give you a glass of water. So you are only looking, where is the water? Because water in Sanskrit is called jivana. One of the words for water in Sanskrit is jivana, life. But all life comes from water. That's why science is always searching. Is there water there? On the Mars. If there is water, there is life. Because life began in water, according to them also. Right? Started in the ocean. So Sanskrit already says this. Jivana. Jalam. So you can live without food for many days, but without water, you will die very quickly. So he says that just like somebody is very hungry and very thirsty, then nothing appeals to such a person. Nothing appeals. So that's how it is described in Brihad Bhagavatam written by Sanatana Goswami, that because King Yudhishthira had also opulence. And then the question may be raised that if he had so much opulence, then where was his devotion? He says, but this opulence did not attract his mind, just like the mind of a person who is very hungry. He is not attracted by anything. He is only thinking, when this class will be over, I will go and have my dinner. If you are hungry, then you are only thinking. Sometimes it happens like some class is going on wrong, long time. Time for breakfast, you are hungry. So you are only thinking, when is it going to stop? Because hunger creates very intense desire in the mind. And it's a very big disturbance to the mind. So he says, like that, nothing is satisfying to him. All this opulence, all this paraphernalia, which I have for enjoyment, this is not giving me any happiness. So he says, Tatar Pahi Mahabhaga Purvai Sahagatam Tapa Tama Yathatarema Dustaram Prajyatad Videhi. He says, therefore, he says, O great sage Mahabhaga, highly fortunate one, I am very unhappy, and even my forefathers, they are unhappy. Purvaisa, they are all going to hell. Gatam tama. He actually says that they are already gone there. And then they will go. He says, we will all go there. And yathatarema dustaram prajayat tadvidehi. He says, somehow, please do something so that we can cross this hell, which we are all going to fall down because there is no condemnation. So this is one of the reasons that people are in a hellish condition, because there is no pindadan. If pindadan is there, then you feel satisfied wherever you are. When there is no pindadan, people are very dissatisfied. When there is so much opulence, people are always dissatisfied. Because no pindadan is coming. So that is the hellish suffering. It doesn't mean you have to go to hell only, but wherever you are, you are just going to suffer. So he says that we have fallen there, gatam tama, we are already there. So somehow uplift us from this hell. There is a story in Mahabharata, this one boy, what is his name? He was a brahmachari, and then he did not enter into household life, did not marry. And one day he was walking, he saw some people hanging from the tree upside down. He was surprised and he asked, what is wrong with you people? He says, we have a rascal descendant who is not getting married, and soon we are going to fall down. So when he heard this, then he decided to marry. Jaratkaru. Jaratkaru. He doesn't stop the sacrifice of King Janmejaya, who is doing a sacrifice to burn all the snakes. He heard that his father was bitten by a snake. So Jaratkaru is the one who stopped. Otherwise there would have been no more snakes. So that story is also to give importance to this marriage and having a son. So same thing we see here. So Bhagavatam, of course, is a transcendental book. but it also speaks about the Purupaksha. You see, this is made here as a Purupaksha. That is the greatness of Bhagavatam. In Mahabharata, that story is a Siddhanta. It seems like the conclusion that one has to get married and have children. And the Indians, they know these stories, then they try to convince the people to become a sadhu. Look, the story is there in Mahabharata. What are you saying? So Bhagavatam is, that's why Vyasa has to write Mahabharata. That's why he was not happy. So he has to write. So here he made the story as a Purupaksha. Because even after having a son, he was not happy. So when he became happy, then he became a devotee. So that's why this idea is refuted. That the conclusion of life is not to get married and have a son. That may be fine, but that is not the highest thing. So that's what we read. So now Sri Sukhdev, Sri Shuka Vacha, Sri Sukhdev said, Iti Arthita Sa Bhagavan Kripalu Brahmana Sutaha Shatitva Charin Pashtram Pashtarambhaya Jad Bhikhu. So then the sage, he heard this, and Sukhdev said that he was Kripalu, and he was also called here as Bhagavan. These are two very important things which are used here. One is Bhagavan, other is Kripalu. Kripalu means compassionate. Bhagavan means who is capable. So Bhagavan means the Supreme Lord, but here it's in the secondary sense. Means who is powerful. So sometimes you want to be compassionate on someone, but you don't have the ability. Then you are in trouble, and the person you want to be compassionate on is also in trouble. So to be compassionate, you should also be qualified. And if I am not qualified to be compassionate, and I try to help, not only that I will not be able to help because I am not qualified, but I will put myself into trouble. So Jiva Goswami says this, that Kripalu or Asamarthas. If Kripalu is, somebody is Kripalu, he is Asamartha. He is not capable. So he says Dukkhaya. And the outcome is only suffering. So that's why here the adjective is used here, Bhagavan Kripalu. So Bhagavan Kripalu, Brahmana Sutta. Son of Brahma. Gira is one of the 10 sons of Brahma. And when he was Arthita, he was asked, requested, prayed to by the king. Then what he did? Shapitva charum tvashtram. Tvashtaram ayajadmi. So that powerful sage, he took some charu. Charu is a mixture of rice and some other ingredients which are used in yagya. So he made a paste, and then with this he did a worship. He did a yagya. So he did a yagya, because by yagya you can take anything. So Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Sahayagya Prajasrishpa, Puruvacha Prajapati, Anil Prasadhu. That this Yagya is there, and this is Ishtakama book. It can fulfill all your desires. So this was custom previously. People wanted Sakam Yagyas, wanted to fulfill some of their desires, and they do Yagya. They went to the sun. Many stories about that in sun. Lord Ramchandra's father, he did a yagya. So this was custom, this was the tradition. So he also did it. Vastram Vastaram Ayajat. So he worshipped Devta called Tvashta and created a charu for him, and then he lived in India. So we also read Prastha when the father of Vishwarupa. He was the knower of Brahma Vidya. He is the one who gave Brahma Vidya to his son, and his son gave it to Indra. And he also taught it to Dadeshi. So these people were very powerful people, so he worshipped him, first around the other people. And then Jyeshtha Shrestha Chaya Ragyo Mahishi Namcha Bharata Namna Pradyutis Tasyai Yagyochishtam Adadvija. So that Brahmana, then what he did, that he gave this remnant of Yagya to the senior most wife, queen, whose name was Kritadyuti. And she was senior and she was also the best, because it is said Jyeshtha and Shrestha. So Shrestha means by quality, by character. Also she was superior to others, and also by her position she was senior most. So senior most and the best queen among all the queens, and she was given this yagyochasta. So what is remaining from the yagya, that is called amrita. So this he gave to him. He said, Shurtra Bhyam Anna Jaleo Kamo Yasvata Matre Shachanda Nami. Previously, that was like when somebody is very hungry, then he is not satisfied if you give him a garland. So you go to somebody's house, you are hungry, he receives you very nicely. Vedic style, chanting mantras, giving garland, putting chandan, and no food. So what are you going to do with the garland? You're only waiting when he's going to ask him for some food. Purvai Pitradhimi Sa Gatam Praptam Tamaha Narkam Prajayatha Parima Patavina. Says, I'm going to fall down to hell along with my forefathers, because there is no son here. So please do something. Tvastram Tvastri Devatakam. Tvastram means belongs to the Tvastri Devata. Pratham Vyudhatvena Jyeshtha Saubhagyati Sena Chasveshtha Yagyotshishtam Yagyashesham Charam. So one who was married first, she is the Jyeshtha, and also the Bhagavad character, she got it. And sometimes what is considered as good fortune also is the bad fortune. Sometimes what is bad fortune is good fortune. It's very difficult to decide what is good and what is bad, because there are so many things. Now she may be feeling very fortunate that she is the one who is getting the charu to eat. But later on she is the one who is going to cry most. Because this is the principle, as I said. What gives you happiness gives you trouble. So the son will give them happiness, also will give distress. So therefore he says, Ataha Nriptim Rajan Bhavita Ekastavatma Jaha Harsha Shoka Pradastubhyam Iti Brahma Suto Yayav. So he told to the king that, O king, you will have a son, Atmaja. So Atmaja is the word used for son, which literally means which is born from your Atma. The son is there like Atma. And but he also told him in a cryptic way, Harsha Shoka Prada, that he will give you happiness and also distress. And after saying this, that son of Brahma, he left him. So this is very interesting that Angira, because he already said that the sage knows past, present and future, so he already knew what will happen. Therefore he is already informing the king that you will have a son who will be the cause of your happiness and distress. So of course the king did not pay attention to the second part. Because when you are very much intent on something, you say, I don't care what happens, let me get this, then I will see. Anytime it happens, you are desiring something. So, you know that some problem can come from this. So he said, no problem, let me first fulfill my desire. Later on, if something unwanted, undesirable happens, I will see. So the king therefore did not pay his attention to the second part of what he said, Shoka Prada. And he just, because we are so much attached to happiness that we do not pay attention. Therefore you try to tell anybody that don't do this, you will be in trouble. So he said, no problem, you will get people smoke or drink. It's written everywhere, smoking is injurious to health. They don't pay attention. Because they don't understand that what comes first. So this is the Rajasik Sukh, right? Happiness in Rajas, which gives you the happiness in the beginning. And later on gives you trouble. So who sees later on? We are interested in here and now, right? That is the power of now. So let's get happiness now. And smoke. But there is only now. So this is their logic. So Sri Vishnu Chakravarti, he comments, Harsha Shoka Prada Iti Kena Prakarena Harsha Prada Kena Prakarena Shoka Da इति संप्रति अहम किम ब्रवीमि जन्म मृत्यु भ्याम राजायव आयत्याम ज्ञास्यति. सो द मीनिंग ऑफ दिस वर्ड हर्ष शोक प्रद. हर्ष मीन्स हैप्पीनेस, शोक मीन्स डिस्ट्रेस, प्रद मीन्स द गिवर, दैट ही विल बी द गिवर ऑफ हैप्पीनेस एंड गिवर ऑफ डिस्ट्रेस. सो ही सेज एट प्रेजेंट व्हाट कैन आई से अबाउट दिस. The sage is thinking inside and speaking. So he says, king will know it for sure, because the child will take birth and he will die very soon. Kincha iyam apriyoktirapi samprati avasya vachya eva. So then why is he saying it? Because what he is saying is not very pleasing. So his statement, satyam bruyat, priyam bruyat, Ma Priyat Satyam Apriyam, Ma Satyam Priyat Esha Dharma Sanatana. That you should speak truth and speak palatable truth. And don't speak the unpalatable truth, but also don't tell lies. This is the Sanatana Dharma. So why is he speaking the unpalatable truth? So he was kept quiet. He said, okay, you will have a son, now I'm going. Why is he saying? He is saying he is trying to protect him. What can happen in future? But he says that Agre Ragya Dasyamanasya Palambanasya Pratyuttarartham Iti Mansi Vimrishya Tattvam Spashta Manutvaya. So the sage was thinking that in the future the boy is going to die. And if I need him, then he is going to taunt me. That what did you do? What kind of a son you gave me? I had him and he died. What is the use of such a son? So he says that, thinking that if he says like this, if he criticizes me like this, then I say, look, I already told you that you have shot for that. You need to hear? Didn't I say this to you? So he says, therefore he is laying the ground for himself to be on the safe side. speaking like this, he left. So putra me bahu gunanvito bhavishyati iti harsada tadapi aishwarya adhikyat na me vachas karo bhavishyati iti shokda iti bhavat tad dukham maya sodhavyam iti mansi vichari raja to ananda anandaye viti gain. So what was the thinking of the king? The thinking of the king was positive. He said that I will have a son and this is the cause of happiness. And but the son, because he will be born in such an opulence and after so much desiring, so naturally he will get spoiled. But everybody will be affectionate, and when you are too much affectionate to the child, then the child gets spoiled. The Guru Chanakya Pandit said that Laliyat Panchvarshani, Dasvarshani Tadiyat, Prapte Shodase Varshe, Uttam Mitravat Acharit. For 5 years, you will be very affectionate. For the next 10 years, you will respect. And once he is 16, then behave with him like a friend. So there is a lot of wisdom behind this statement. But the king is thinking that I am not going to be strict with him. And he will have all opulence. And therefore he will not be obedient. And that will be the cause of my distress. So he says, that distress I must tolerate. So maya sodhavya. Mansi vicharya, thinking like this, he just felt happy. So this is good. Otherwise he would have become distressed. So he is having a positive attitude. At least I will have a son. So this is how the king, he took it. And of course he did not understand it's not that the son is not going to be just disobedient. He is actually going to die and then he would suffer so much. So he did not consider that. So because everybody thinks in one's own mind, and our mind of course is colored with our desires. We interpret others' words accordingly. So it's a good statement. Dada, the Dhanas and Datya and human beings, everybody took it differently. He's talking about Daya and Dhan. So everybody takes the words in their own way. So King took it that is the words. So we stop for today. Tomorrow we'll see how the story proceeds.
Of Agiras is very interesting because actually he put the king into so much misery to teach him what he wanted him to teach. So that means that compassion can mean putting somebody into real trouble to get your good intentions across.
Yeah, that's what is going to help. Because just as Krishna himself said, yasya hamanu brinamu adisyata dhanam sane. That when I give my compassion to somebody, I take away his wealth. Then he says, prajanti dukh dukhita, when all of his relatives, they see he has no money, he is suffering, they leave him. So he puts him in trouble. Because if that's what is going to bring him to devotion, that's good.
my question was, does being compassionate mean to be able to have the courage to put somebody into trouble, to not spare somebody from the trouble?
Yes.
If you know that the trouble leads him to a good end.
Yes.
And even that person may hate you for being put into trouble.
Yeah, it's possible sometimes if he does not understand. It's also possible.
There's this.
I've seen many stories like that. The gurus were so harsh. Mahabharata itself, the story. You know the story of this. He was one of the students. He was going Madhukari, begging and he was also eating on the way.
Upamani.
So then the teacher asked him, like, how is that? He was so healthy. He said, oh Guruji, I go for Madhukari and beg and also eat. He said, no, but that's not right. Whatever you beg, you have to come and bring it to me, and then I said, you should take it from me. That's the principle. Okay, so now he was begging and he was not eating. He would bring and give everything to the Guru. And the Guru did not give him anything. But he was still strong. So after a few days he said that this guy is still strong, what is wrong? So he asked him that, how is that I don't give you anything to eat, you are still strong? He said, oh Guruji, I go and I beg and I give everything to you. And go again. So he says, no, you don't trouble these people, they're giving you one instruction. So he didn't give him any food. And then he was going with the cows. So now he has no food and he cannot go and beg. Whatever he's begging, he's bringing. So he is drinking cow's milk, because there are so many cows, they need milk, so milk is enough, you have a good digestive system, and milk is a perfect diet, you don't need anything. So he was drinking enough milk and he was still happy. So after a few days, the teacher asked him, how that I don't give you any food, you are not begging again, but still you are strong. So it's really no problem. I have cows, I drink their milk. He said, but the cows belong to you, me, and I have not asked you to drink their milk. And the milk is meant for the calf. You drink what the calf is meant to drink. So he said, okay, I don't drink milk. So like that he stopped, but then he was drinking the foam which was left by the calves. He told him don't drink that also. Now so all his avenues were blocked one by one. Finally he was hungry and he fell. He ate this bark, this plant which grows, it's very bitter. Drop of the fruit, flower, and this Lord Shiva. And by eating that he became blind. Fell in a well. So in the evening he did not come back to the cows. And the Guru, of course, was keeping an eye on him. So he asked, where is the money? So nobody knows. So he said, let's go and search for him. They went and searched him. He was calling, Ukmani, Ukmani. And then he replied, yes, Guruji. He said, where are you? He said, I'm in this well. He said, how did he fall into the well? Because I'm blind. Why did he become blind? I was hungry and I ate these leaves. So then he said, okay, I give you this stotra for Aswami Kumara and you pray to them. Then he recited the stotra for Aswami Kumara and Aswami Kumara appeared and they gave him charu, they gave him some sweet rice. Said, you eat it and you'll get your vision back.